Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now we study the Sabbath school lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular lesson is unique for several reasons. This particular quarter has actually 14 Sabbaths in it. So this is lesson number 14 in the Book of Job series. It's for December 31 of 2016, entitled Some Lessons from Job. I wonder what lessons they're going to teach us from or ask us to talk about from the book of Job. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Our wonderful Father, we bow our heads now, recognizing your presence with us. We're asking the Holy Spirit to guide us as we discuss together is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. So how have you felt about the study of the book of Job so far? It seems like there's so many things to talk about in the book of Job. We've just sort of barely begun, and now already we're at the last lesson. But then a lot of people who study modern science and even almost any field today, what you learn from studying a subject in depth is that there's always a lot more to learn. So I guess we shouldn't be surprised. Ellen White put it this way: we have no reason to doubt God's word because we cannot understand the mysteries of his providence. In the natural world, we are constantly surrounded with wonders beyond our comprehension. Should we then be surprised to find in the spiritual world also mysteries that we cannot fathom? The difficulty lies solely in the weakness and narrowness of the human mind. Steps to Christ, page 106, paragraph 2. But we need to be honest. To get the right answers, you have to ask the right questions. So what was it that Job said or did that was right in contrast to what the friend said or did? Because remember, back in Job 1 and Job 2, God said, Job is a righteous and an upright man. So what was it that, and then in Job 42, at the end, he says, Job has said to me what is right. So those are the things. Maybe we should just read those verses once again, just to remind ourselves. After the Lord had finished speaking to Job, he said to Eliphaz, I am angry with you and your two friends. Now, how would you feel if God said to you he was angry with you? Because you did not speak the truth about me as my servant Job did. Now take seven bulls and seven rams to Job and offer them as a sacrifice for yourselves. Job will pray for you, and I will answer his prayer and not disgrace you as you deserve. You did not speak the truth about me as he did. So that's the question we still need to answer. What was it that Job said that was truth that his enemies, his so-called friends, didn't say or contradicted him?
Back in the end of chapter 1, this is just after the first round of calamities, it says, through all this Job did not sin, nor did he blame God, or the margin says literally ascribe unseemliness to God. So all through this, he's not saying that God is necessarily wrong in what he's doing. He just wants to know why all this is happening. That could be one possible reason.
We are learning from the movie industry and lots of other places that it's possible to fool the human eye. You can make things, I mean, there are movies now, huge movies, that are, you know, billion-dollar producers that were put together, and they never, I mean, none of the events actually happened at the time. There are pieces that are put together in various ways.
Computer-generated.
Computer-generated, right. So what do you suppose that has to do? You know, there's a couple of verses here that we're asked to look at. 2 Corinthians 5:7. For our life is a matter of faith, not of sight. What does that mean? And 4:18, 2 Corinthians 4:18. For we fix our attention not on things that are seen, but on things that are unseen. What can be seen lasts only for a time, but what cannot be seen lasts forever. So were there some unseen things in the book of Job?
There are unseen things in our lives. Because who has ever seen perfect love? Especially collective perfect love. We've seen it in the person of Jesus. We've never seen how it works collectively. And yet we can imagine what it can be like, so we can see something that our eyes cannot see.
Well, in the case of the book of Job, of course, the whole discussion all through the book wouldn't have happened if they had known what was unseen at chapters 1 and 2, right?
Right.
So often the most important truths are the ones connected to the great controversy, as we call it, over God's character and government and our spiritual relationship to that. So did any of the people involved, did any of the people involved in the book of Job understand and really grasp what was going on at the time? Do you think any of them did?
I think the problem was that they thought they did.
Yes.
In Proverbs it says to get knowledge and wisdom and understanding, but then it says don't lean on your understanding. You know, trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him and he will make your paths straight. Do not be wise in your own eyes.
Yeah.
And that's part of the problem with the counselors, is they all thought they understood things, and Job at least was saying, I don't understand what's going on.
My wife reminds me every once in a while that I jump to conclusions, as far as she's concerned anyway. Mm-hmm. These guys, the whole argument, all the way from beginning to end, was based on false conclusions. False assumptions, really. False assumptions.
Incomplete data.
Incomplete.
Because God does speak of blessings and cursings to Israel later on, if they follow him, and we even pick that up in Revelation also. So there is an element of that, but there's more to it. That's part of the thing, is we don't see it all, just as they didn't see it all.
I don't know if any of you have had the experience of some calamity or even just some unusual experience that you have no explanation for.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what about the explanation for evil? You know how much this is discussed. In our world, where many people, especially educated people, doubt the existence of God and certainly the existence of a real personal devil, that question is a real challenge. One United States Supreme Court justice is famous for stating regarding evil in a certain case, we know it when we see it. What does that mean? Is it an inherent human reality that we're just born with this innate sense of what's right?
Well, I think back to the Supreme Court justice, it's saying there's no external standards, but when we experience it, you know, so evil just becomes experiential, on an experiential plane or an internal plane.
What seems to be happening in our world today is everybody's just trying to decide what's right for themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think everybody else should think the way I do. You know? Well, don't we depend on the Holy Spirit in making correct judgments? We should. Well, there are, in terms of evil, there are two broad categories of evil that we know about. We talk about natural evil or natural calamities and moral evil. What's a natural evil?
I didn't know there was a difference. This is new to me.
Disasters.
Well, we talk about natural disasters, hurricanes and floods and lightnings and, you know.
Well, that's bad, but is it evil?
Earthquakes.
Was it earthquakes? Part of God's original plan?
Yeah, what's the difference between bad and evil?
There is a difference.
There is?
Yeah, there's a sin that won't come unto death. Huh? That's bad.
Yeah,
but it's not evil.
I see. Well, by contrast, moral evil is something that results from the actions of human thinking or actions of human beings. Well, as Seventh-day Adventist believers who accept the scriptural accounts, we are certain that the former Lucifer, now Satan, is the one responsible for all evil. You really can't claim that you believe the Bible unless you accept that. So, what is Satan doing now in our world?
What did you just say there? I don't quite get it.
Well, what I said was, if you believe the Bible record, you believe that Satan is a real being, that he has real intents to try to destroy, to hate, to cause hate, to damage, to whatever, that he's not some mystical nothing force out there. This guy is for real.
Okay.
I would like to suggest that Satan is doing everything he possibly can to get us to believe that he does not exist. Why would he want to do that? If he can accomplish that, then when he appears, hopefully not too far distant future, claiming to be Jesus Christ himself, we will believe him. Because he can't be the devil, because there's no devil, right? But we are warned by the book of Job about the kinds of results that would take place if Satan were in charge. We must not make the mistake that Job's friends did and the Pharisees and most of the Jews did in Jesus' day, that is, blaming God for everything that happens. If we do that, we're playing right into Satan's hands. Well, what did we learn from Job 1 and 2 about what's going on behind the scenes?
He creates havoc, destruction.
When God allows him to do so, he will create havoc. And think about it for a moment. If he was creating havoc back then, if God allowed him free access to everybody on this earth, what would he do? What do you think?
He'd destroy everything.
Yeah. Well, and who would be his first targets? All the people who are trying to follow God, right? Those are the people. The devil would love to destroy all of God's followers, and then he would just turn to God and say, okay, everybody who's left on planet earth here is following me, so you just go and you can have the rest of the universe. I don't care. Just give me this world, and this will be my home and my people, and just leave us alone. And how does God respond to that? That not only am I not going to leave you alone, I'm going to make this world my future headquarters. I just chuckle when I think about that little discussion between Satan and God. I'm sure that's happened many times, that discussion has happened. Well, Job's accusers blamed God, and they blamed Job, but they never blamed Satan. Why don't you think Satan was never mentioned in this whole discussion? Did they really not know anything about Satan?
One of the ruses of Satan is to make God appear as though he's the author of a lot of this evil. Mm-hmm. And this is part of the story we have here in Job.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. Satan would love to make us think, yes.
You got chapter 1. It says, fire fell from God from heavens and burned up the sheep and the servants and consumed them. Here in Job, chapter 1, it's attributing mm-hmm. the evil to God.
Yeah.
There's
no need to invoke Satan.
No.
People have suggested that it was lightning that destroyed all those animals. And I thought, you could see lightning coming down and strike maybe one animal or two animals like this, but just recently on the news, something happened. I didn't get all the details, but a lightning storm struck a herd of caribou way up in Norway somewhere and killed hundreds of them. And I don't know whether this is a bunch of different strikes or just all one strike, but killed a whole bunch of them. So it can happen.
Probably fracking caused it.
Fracking, I see. Okay. Well, how hard does the devil have to work to tempt us?
Probably not very hard.
Most of us have probably become such easy targets for Satan's temptations that our bad actions have become habits.
Well, how much work did he do on Eve?
Yeah.
And the third of the heavenly intelligences, over time.
Yeah, remember James 1 just says, we just do it, just out of our own habits.
God tempts no one and he cannot be tempted.
Yeah.
Doesn't it happen, though, when you're separated from God?
Yeah.
Isn't the whole question whether or not you ought to stay with God? Well, you don't even have to blame the devil. If you decide to get away from God, you'll do just what he does.
Who is it that wants to separate you from God?
Well, you can decide to separate from God if you want.
And who would want you to do that?
would want you to do that? Well, if you decided to do it, you would want to do it.
I see. Well, there's a lot of verses in the Bible, and on our handout, which is available to you, by the way, if you're interested in this, you can go to our website at Theox, that's T-H-E-O-X, T-H-E-O-X dot O-R-G, and Revelation 12:12, Matthew 4:10, 13:39, so forth, all kinds of places through the New Testament. It talks about the specific actions of the devil. And I would be so bold as to say it's impossible to deny the existence and power of Satan unless you're ready to throw the Bible out. So what kind of opinion have you developed over this last quarter and even before in your studies of the book of Job of Job's friends? Were they just loony or?
I could hear those messages most any pulpit more than once a week.
Mm-hmm. Well, I kind of think that this was new. I think that everybody thought that God manipulated through rewards and shuns. And I think Job showed that that wasn't true. And I even suspect that the angels thought that.
Yeah,
this was a new experience. This was a new revelation to everybody. That maybe God the whole universe, that God doesn't manipulate through reward and or shunning. Mm-hmm. That you do have sovereignty deep inside you to do what you choose to do.
Look at Job's friends. During that first week, if you had observed them just sitting there quietly respecting Job, what would you have said about them? Very sympathetic, mm-hmm. Wonderful neighbors, wonderful friends, right? And then Job starts to speaking out about what he's all suffered with and so forth. And then what do? They jump in to attack him. And why did they do that?
They thought they were right.
Yeah, and they have a false knowledge of God.
Yeah.
Well, they thought that God was punishing him.
They believed it was their job to straighten Job out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Job, you got to see this. I look at you.
Mm-hmm. Well, and as it turns out, because Job refused to accept their accusations, they never got beyond accusing. They sort of lost any sympathy and compassion that they seemed to have back at the beginning. And think about this. Our Bible study guide asks us to think about this. Even if Job had been guilty, was it helpful to him to have these people come along and just blame him for all kinds of things? Is that the work that God gives us to do?
I think sometimes it's important to put all the ideas on the table, mm-hmm. whether they're right, wrong, or indifferent. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, out of all those ideas, the truth might come out. And that's why it's so important to express what we believe, and these guys did. Whether they ended up understanding what mm-hmm. God was trying to teach, that's not for us to know, apparently.
Well, in Galatians 6:1, it says, "Brethren, even if anyone is caught in a trespass, you who are spiritual, mm-hmm. restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, each one looking to yourself so that you too will not be tempted." Mm-hmm. So there is admonition, but it does say you who are spiritual, whatever Paul meant by that. But I think he meant he has something to minister or to lift that person up, to give them a choice to change if there was. But part of it is these people thought they had all the pieces of the puzzle and they were ready to condemn him.
Yep.
And I think a spiritual person would come and try to sort things out in a way that the person knew that they were loved.
What was it that Job was repeatedly asking for?
God's response.
Yeah. He said, if I could just talk to God, we're going to see some of those verses a little bit later. If I could just talk to God, I'm sure that we would get the answer to all of this. And how did they feel about talking to God? Well,
Go ahead, read it.
Yeah. Elihu had his words to say. Look at Job 37, verse 20. "I won't ask to speak with God. Why should I give him a chance to destroy me?" So So what kind of an attitude did he have toward God?
Well, he thought that if he saw God, it would destroy him, and yeah. So he didn't want to even come close. Much like the Israelites, when they saw the thunder and heard the voice and everything.
He was scared that he would do something wrong.
That's why we have the notion of fearing God throughout Scripture, because it was so traditional to fear the gods. Mm-hmm. They were always against humans. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes this pagan concept ended up infiltrating those who were supposed to be children of God.
There's one of the ancient, fairly commonly known myths of ancient times was that the gods started fighting because humans weren't doing their dirty work for them like they were supposed to be. You know, just craziness. Well, we've already talked about Job's speech. I'm sorry, God's speech from chapters 38 to 41 especially. And did God answer Job's questions? Not apparently. What did God talk about?
His transcendence, his great power.
Creative power.
That he didn't say it here, but his ways are beyond our ways. Mm-hmm. And so how can we understand? How can we understand what he's doing if we can't answer the questions about the creation and all these other things?
So now, did any of the speakers in the book of Job question God's sovereignty, God's power? Is there any place where they said, well, God can't do this or that or the other? So they all pretty much agreed that God had the power, right? Well, let's assume for a moment that they all heard the speech from God. And were they all ready to say at the end of that speech, God has said it, we believe it, and that's all, it settles it for us? Think they're ready to say that?
And to process it, probably.
Well, God didn't really give him an answer at the end. He just said Job was right. Mm-hmm. So now they got to just ponder what Job was talking about and figure out what it was that he was right about.
Well, after God gave that speech, and he said, okay, they all look like they're all, yeah, they're all respectful. Oh, yes, whatever you say, God. Then he says, guess what? Eliphaz, I'm angry with you and your two friends because you did not speak the truth about me as my servant Job did. They were going, huh? We're sure we were here to straighten Job out. There were a lot of shocks, I'm sure, at the end of the book of Job. You think his friends ever figured out what that was all about? Or did they go home just as confused and puzzled as they came?
The story doesn't tell us.
No?
Well, it's kind of what happens to us when we read Job. Don't we just kind of ponder it and ponder it? Mm-hmm. I'm sure that their friends did the same thing after they went home, after all mm-hmm. that.
See, I think the problem is, what do you call the power of God?
Yeah.
If we consider the power of God his might and his ability to make things really happen or blow up, then we have a wrong idea about God. Mm-hmm. And this is kind of the way the friends thought about God. Job is showing that God is sweet, soft, soft-spoken. He works in the heart. He doesn't work with a club. Mm-hmm. And he approaches the problem of evil in a way that we would never think of it here as humans. Mm-hmm. We have a Skinnerian attitude towards education, its reward or its punishment. But God works in a different way. He says, no, it's humility first, because that leads to love.
Mm. Yeah. Well, look at Job 42:11. This is one of the puzzling verses. Job 42:11. All Job's brothers and sisters and former friends, would these three or four that we've been reading about all through the book, would they be considered former friends? Came to visit him and feasted with him in his house. They expressed their sympathy and comforted him for all the troubles the Lord had brought on him. Each of them gave him some money and a gold ring. Oh, we're so sorry, Job. God just really beat up on you.
I wonder if that money was probably all he had right then.
Possibly. Well, had the Lord really brought the troubles on Job?
No.
We know from chapter 1 and 2 that it was the devil, don't we? That's right. Well, our Bible study guide wants to remind us of a very different story found in John chapter 8, the story of the woman taken in adultery. And how did Jesus treat her?
He did not condemn her. He just said, go and sin no more.
He didn't stand up and say, you sinner. I think if he had been inclined to do that, he should have started with the guys who brought her. You know, but what did he actually do? He probably wrote their sins in the dust. Mm-hmm. Because what does it say about what they did?
They left starting with the oldest one. So there was a certain order to the whole thing.
This wasn't just a random leaving.
Right.
Well, Ellen White says these words about that. In his act of pardoning this woman and encouraging her to live a better life, the character of Jesus shines forth in the beauty of perfect righteousness. While he does not palliate sin or lessen the sense of guilt, he seeks not to condemn but to save. The world had for this erring woman only contempt and scorn, but Jesus speaks words of comfort and hope. Desire of Ages 462, paragraph 3. Well, if we were suffering, any one of us, suffering some terrible calamity, either because of an actual sin or for no apparent reason, how would you like your friends to treat you? Would you be happy to have some of Job's comforters come around and light into you? Is there ever go ahead?
Yeah, Matthew 18, where you know, you go individually instead of talking about it and going to the pastor and say, you go talk to him.
Yeah.
You know, it's, you know, you should go individually and be spiritual, as Paul mentions in Galatians, and try to love them and seek to understand whether you saw things correctly. I remember Dr. Leslie Harding talking about how they were doing some work at the church he was pastoring once, and they were moving this blackboard, and rather than the chalk falling on the floor, he picked it up and he stuck it in his mouth, and somebody then started this rumor that the pastor was smoking. Rather than trying to sort through and see what was really going on here.
Mm-hmm.
Because we want to be Sherlock Holmes, you know, and see a few things and come to a quick decision and say, this is it.
Okay. Has God ever given us the job of judging? That's not our job. That's God's job. And obviously, he does it so much better than we would do. Now, it's true. We're told, Paul says it in 1 Corinthians right there, if somebody's committing blatant open sin and everybody knows about it, the church might need to take action, obviously, to try to preserve the reputation of the church. But in general, we should not be taking the judgment seat of God. That's his responsibility. Well, our world is a vast sea of suffering, disease, sickness, poverty, war, crime, depression, pollution, and injustice. Secular witness writers and atheists struggle with the meaningless of lives that they believe have no reason for starting and no reason for ending. It's completely chance. It is sometimes called nihilism, from the Latin word nihil, which means nothing. However, the book of Job suggests that every one of us is a part of a much larger theater. And what verse does that come from? 1 Corinthians 4, verse 9, right? We are the theater of the universe. Our lives do matter. Our cases will come up individually before God and the universe. We have the hope of one day returning to heaven and living with God for the rest of eternity. So our lives do matter. Many biblical students and scholars have compared the experiences of Job with the experiences of Jesus. These experiences should also be compared to what we have been told will take place at the end of human history. And we don't have time to read all these verses, but Job 1:1, compare that with 1 John 2:1, and James 5:6, and Acts 3:14, and so forth, and read on through those verses. What parallels do you see here? Well, let's think of some. Jesus and Job were both righteous, although Job was not sinless. Through their lives, both of them brought glory to the Father. Both were severely tested and accused of doing all sorts of terrible things that they didn't do. Neither Job nor Jesus collapsed under pressure. They stayed faithful to God. As wonderful as the story of Job is, in his suffering, his faithfulness in the face of terrible accusations is only a small and imperfect reflection of what Jesus, our Savior, faced on our behalf. One of the questions that has been raised, which we have mentioned briefly, was the question, how did God speak out of the storm? Was this just sort of whoosh, as the wind went by, it sort of sounded like somebody speaking, or what happened?
What's recorded seems like an audible voice. It has structure and diction and such.
What do we have any other evidence in ancient times of people talking with God or hearing God speak?
Elijah. Moses.
Elijah is a very clear example. It happened many times to him. Moses.
Abraham.
Abraham.
And of course, in the beginning, Adam and
right?
Cain and
Enoch.
So forth.
Yeah, Enoch is an example. Ellen White says, Prophets and Kings, page 486, God actually taught Daniel and his friends. So is it possible that God spoke to Job? Seemed like it was happening a lot in those days, didn't it? Well, while the book of Job is a real challenge, we, of course, will never get answers to all the questions it raises. For example, well, I shouldn't say never, at least not this side of the kingdom. But again, we have been told in Great Controversy, page 678, that we will be studying the plan of salvation and all its implications for the rest of eternity. So how could we possibly fully comprehend it now? So if you feel like the book of Job is a little too confusing or too complicated for you to understand, stand by, don't give up, follow God. You'll have the rest of eternity to work on it. Well, fortunately for us who like to study those kinds of things, the book of Job was just a small part of a much bigger scenario, much bigger opus, if you want to call it, of God's revelation of himself. Where else can we look for God's revelation of himself?
Nature.
And the rest of the book, rest of the Bible, right? And we as Seventh-day Adventists look to the writings of Ellen White. So we can put the stories of Job in that larger context. Well, try to imagine yourself living among the Jews just before Jesus came. Think about John 9, for example. What did they say about that blind man? Who sinned, this man or his parents? They believed that terrible disasters, illnesses, whatever, deformities, were a direct result of sin, either of the person himself or of his parents. And here's the interesting comments that Ellen White gives us about that. Thus the way was prepared for the Jews to reject Jesus. He who hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows was looked upon by the Jews as stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. And they hid their faces from him, Isaiah 53:4-3. God had given a lesson designed to prevent this attitude. The history of Job had shown that suffering is inflicted by Satan and is overruled by God for purposes of mercy. But Israel did not understand the lesson. The same error for which God had reproved the friends of Job was repeated by the Jews in their rejection of Christ, Desire of Ages 4:71. Wow. You think that was one of the main reasons why God gave the book of Job? To try to prevent that exact thing?
That's what it says.
Seems to be true, right? So as we come to the end of the book of Job, can we explain God's statement, Eliphaz? Job's friend's main accusation of Job was that his picture of God was an error, yeah. Right? His picture of God was mistaken. They were sure that they were speaking the truth about God. And they end up quoting who in defense of their picture of God?
The devil.
The devil himself. Incredible. But we, Ellen White says, and we could even look at 2 Corinthians 11:14 to support this, even the devil and his angels will appear to be converted at the end. And Satan, 1 Peter, Satan will appear as an angel of light. And the whole world will be crying, what? Christ has come, Christ has come. Great Controversy, page 624, paragraph 2. And the devil is God's worst enemy. So why are all these mistaken and deceptive speeches recorded in the Bible? I mean, shouldn't the Bible just be a pure presentation of truth? Why do we have all these mistakes and accusations and so forth in the Bible?
It seems that the children of Israel all had a false picture of God in their minds. And that's the reason Jesus had to come, was to rectify this false image of God. As long as we have a false image of God in our minds, we see him as being vindictive, we see him as being ready to judge, when in reality that is the picture that pagans have of their gods. And who is their God? The devil.
Yeah.
Well, a lot of scripture is made up of stories, and so you have the characters that are there, and they're saying things. Otherwise, God would just have a sermon as the Bible.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you have these interactions, and we see how God reacts to those sorts of things.
So what we get is a picture of what actually happened. The Bible is an accurate report of what actually happened. What would you say is the most important thing we should learn from this series of lessons in the book of Job?
Well, there are several lessons.
Okay.
Perhaps the first one is that no matter how much we think we know about God, there's more to learn.
And we certainly should learn that there are two very conflicted forces at work in the world today, and both of them would like to control us, wouldn't they? So,
in 1 Corinthians 8, Paul says that if any man thinks he knows anything, he has not yet known as he ought to have known.
Yeah. So, many of scholars have said that the book of Job is a book trying to explain why the righteous suffer. Is that the main message of Job?
Probably not.
I would suggest that maybe one of the most important things that is found in the book of Job is a proof that God can be trusted and his judgments of people are accurate. In his foreknowledge, yeah. Well, do you think God won his case or did he lose in the book of Job?
The point is subtle. So you only get God's point if you listen to the still small voice, which is always subtle, and you have to pay attention to that still small voice. The other voice of the traditional view of God is thunderous. You don't have to listen to it, but here you do. And I think that if we learn to listen to what God is saying as opposed to what we think he is saying, which is what the theologians do. And the devil was the first theologian. He's trying to tell us what God meant to say. Yeah. No, what does he say?
Very good. And surely it would be a disaster to study the book of Job, as many do, by and large leaving out chapters 1 and 2 and 42.
That's right.
I mean, here's this long discussion in the middle, and oh, there's all these arguments back and forth, and you know, oh, what happened back here in the beginning? What happened over here at the end, you know?
Very important method to study that book is the first two chapters and the last chapter, and then
the
go
whole
back
thing.
And start over again.
Yeah, but it parallels the Bible.
Yeah, oh yes,
if absolutely. You look at the beginning of the Bible, you don't get the message until you get to Revelation. And what does Revelation tell us?
Yeah. Well, God says at the beginning, at the end of Job, just as he says at the end, as you mentioned, the book of Revelation, he says, I'm going to win. I'm going to be proven right. And whether we recognize it or not, it's true.
I will look like a loser all along, and all of a sudden, you're going to get the point. And this is the amazing thing about the book of Revelation. It's a call to a transformation.
Look at things very differently than what everybody else is at.
What's the definition of success for God in Job? What is the definition of him winning? If he won, what was he after that?
Well, he says,
Chapter 1 and 2,
and then chapter 42, he says, Job has said to me, he said, this is what I say about Job. And at the end he says, Job has said to me what's right. So it sounds to me like what God wants is a correct representation of himself by us in our lives and in our speech.
And if we do that, there is progress as there was in the life of Job, mm-hmm. who obviously was righteous at the beginning, but even more so at the end.
Now, how much of a portrait is being shown here with Job on the ash heap? With sores all over him, mm-hmm. and it happened all the way till God was done speaking. So what kind of portrait is being portrayed there?
Well, here's the thing. Many theologians will tell you that God wins by proclaiming, just making a statement. It's true because God says so. That's it. If that were true, the whole book of Job is a waste of time. God wins his case by giving evidence. And the devil says, I don't believe it. God says, okay, we'll watch and see. Just watch. We'll let Job go through this crucible. He'll go through this incredible experience. And why? So that I can make a statement at the end? No. Because there's the evidence. That's what really matters. That's how God wins his case. He wins it by presenting the evidence.
Which is persuasive.
Yes. Yeah, for people who really care, for those who really care about God, that's what matters.
And that's what the truth is, what Jesus says in John 18:37. Mm-hmm. I came to bear witness to the truth. But the next sentence is, and a paraphrase would be, it's only effective with those that are searching for or have a thirst for truth. Otherwise,
really
truth
them.
Doesn't really matter.
So, I guess, to conclude that little discussion, did Job let God down?
No, he demonstrated that God was right in judging him at the beginning as being righteous, and he demonstrated that even through troubles and difficulties, he could still be righteous at the end.
There are so many commentaries and so many theologians that just get all wound up at the discussion in the book, and then they don't know what to do with the chapter at the end. That's so sad.
I've just noticed here, chapter 42, verse 6, therefore I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes. I think Job was overwhelmed. It was.
So we would say then that the conflict between Job and the three, or really four friends, was their picture of God.
Exactly.
Their picture of God. Job had one idea about God based on his experience with God from the past, and they had a very different idea. They absolutely believed that their idea was correct.
And they were, in effect, judging God, weren't they?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Why did...
They thought it was their job to speak for Job. Yeah. Their job to speak for Job. I'm getting Job and Job getting mixed up here.
Why did Job have to repent in dust and ashes if he didn't do anything wrong?
It's just
It's an expression. That's what they expected. That's what they expected. So Job thought, well, okay.
Well, that's not very clear.
Well, yeah.
Little nuances.
They kept saying, Job, you've committed some terrible sin.
It's obvious. Look at you.
But if he didn't, and he spoke correctly of God, why at the end is he, therefore I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes? Why did he say that?
It's humility on the part of Job, and he learned something important. Dust and ashes implies humility here. And he says, my ears had heard about you, but now my eyes have even seen you.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. But he still used the word repent, which means go back. Mm-hmm. Go back from where you knew before.
I'd like to read just a few words from a whole collection. I have a list in my handout here of places where Job speaks about what's important to him. Job 6:8. Why won't God give me what I ask? Why won't he answer my prayer? In other words, I want to talk to him. And then there's lots of places where he applies the idea, my life makes no sense. In other words, God, please explain what's happening. God is so wise and powerful. Job 9, verse 4. No one can stand up against him. Job 9, verse 8. No one helped God spread out the heavens or trampled sea monsters back. God, you're powerful enough. Why don't you come back and tell me? Job 9, verse 12. He takes what he wants and no one can stop him. No one dares ask him, what are you doing? And then Job 9, verse 24. And if God didn't do it, who did? He's trying to say, okay, friends, I hear you, but I know that I haven't committed some terrible sin, so why is all this happening to me? God could answer if he just would. And he goes on, and I'll pick out a few more. Job 12, verse 10, it is God who directs the lives of his creatures. Everyone's life is in his power. And then Job 13, 23 and 24, what are my sins? What wrongs have I done? What crimes am I charged with? Why do you avoid me? Why do you treat me like an enemy? And who's he addressing?
God.
Yeah. And I don't know how many of these we read. Look at Job 21, verses 14 to 16. The wicked tell God to leave them alone. They don't want to know his will for their lives. Their way of thinking, I can't accept. Okay, and then Job 23, 10 verses, the first 10 verses. Most of all, Job just wanted for God to speak with him. And then Job 29, 2 and 3, if only my life could once again be as it was when God watched over me. God was always with me then. It gave me light as I walked through the darkness. And I'm gonna stop there. But there's a lot of places. Job just again and again and again, God, please say something. What was Jesus' worst contention, his worst worry on the cross?
My God, why have you forsaken me?
Why have you forsaken me? So, is it a sin to ask God why?
Apparently not.
Jesus did it. Yeah. Job asked it lots of times.
Teach, you can't learn if you don't ask why.
Is it wrong to cry out to God? Jesus did that, didn't he? So, how would you compare the cries of Jesus and the cries of Job? Or if you really had faith in God, should you say, oh, it's okay, problem. God, don't worry. God, just, everything's going to work out. I just trust you.
It's more than faith. It's really understanding. When he says, my eyes have seen you, he's literally saying, now I get it. Mm-hmm. There's something I didn't get before when I heard you, but now that I'm seeing you, there's a lot more for me to understand. And I think it's the understanding that's really important. Mm-hmm. It is easy to do what we're told to do, whether we do it with the right attitude or not. Yeah. It's much harder to understand something and act because of we understand that's mm-hmm. the way it needs to be. Yeah.
And we've talked about this before, but let me just summarize a little bit here. The people who understand will try to move in the right direction, even if the whole crowd is going the other way. And that's the story of Job, isn't it? The people who don't understand, that it's a lot easier to just sort of move with the crowd. Okay.
Obviously, he was not talking about my physical eyes have seen you. It was the eyes of his heart and mind that had seen God.
Yeah, yeah. Well, both Job, and this is a really important point to me anyway in the book of Job. Both Job and Jesus felt a terrible loss. It was a disaster to them that God wasn't speaking to them. How many of us feel like if God's not in communion with us, if we don't have a chance to hear his word every day at least, and maybe several times a day, speaking to us, and it could be through the reading of the Bible, do we feel a terrible loss?
In reality, he was speaking to them all along. It's just that they didn't catch the message, mm-hmm. because the message was so subtle. It was that still small voice again. And there it is. We get it at the end of the chapter.
Well, look at Elijah's experience. He follows God's direction. There's 3.5 years of drought. He goes to the top of Mount Carmel and he speaks. I mean, can you just imagine? They have tried all day. Those wicked people have tried to get the fire going on their altar, and it couldn't go. And finally, Elijah said, "Now it's my turn." And he kneels down. He builds the altar, and he puts the wood, and he puts the sacrifice, and he pours the water over it. And he kneels down, and the whole country is watching him. You think he felt like he was under a little pressure? He kneels down there, and he prays, and a lightning out of heaven goes zap. And what happens? I mean, wow. The sacrifice is gone, and the wood is gone, and the stones are gone, and the water is gone, and there's a black hole in the ground.
And when he got done with all that experience and destroyed all those pagan priests and so forth, yeah. Did he still understand? He didn't understand until he heard the still small voice on the all of that experience. So a lot of that power, it overwhelms you, but is have you really got it settled in your noggin?
God only used that power, so to speak, like on Mount Sinai. He does it here with Elijah. Because sometimes people need to see that just to recognize his reality, his presence.
Well, and most of the history of our world has been, people have had the idea that might makes right. Think about it. If your army is stronger than somebody else's army and you conquer them, then you are right. You have the power, you have the authority to rule because might makes right. Well, think about the displays of power, God's discussion of power in the book of Job. Who was the monster that God created that only God could control?
Leviathan?
I prefer to call him the devil.
Oh, mm-hmm. Okay.
Didn't God create him? Yeah, he's the monster that only God can control. And
but God can't. God can limit the person. But ultimately, what Satan does and what the evil people do or evil intelligences do ultimately has to be demonstrated so that the righteous will have that understanding that they learn will have staying power for eternity.
What does it teach you about God's love to say at the end, he didn't say, condemn those awful rascals who've been saying all those awful things about me. No, what did he say? He said, Job, please pray for these people.
Yeah,
they need to understand me better. Yeah. Please pray for them. What an incredible picture. When Job said, I repent, Gary, this was your comment, did God say, finally, it's about time. Let's ask these other men to pray for you so you can get your life straightened out. Does God ever mention Job's sins? What do you think Job said in his prayer for the four friends? Have you ever tried to speculate about that?
Help them to see the light.
Yeah.
As he saw it with his own eyes.
Mm-hmm. Did God say something like, because I created this universe, including the world with all its forms of life, and because I rule over all and control the relationships that exist among living creatures, why should you doubt my capacity to control the affairs of your life? Why should you, with your unlimited vision, question the justice of my dealings? Did God expect Job to just say, okay, God, I recognize that you're in charge, so no problem? No, Job pleaded with God, why? When are you going to say something? Please, talk to me. Do you think Job might have said after listening to God's speech about the time he said, I repent in dust and ashes, did he then say to himself, well, God, after listening to your speech, God, I have more questions than I did before. who did this to your beautiful creation? So even if we have not experienced significant suffering in our own lives so far, does the book of Job have a message for each one of us? What kind of a message?
keep on listening to God and not to what people say about God.
Mm-hmm. God is in control even in the midst of the suffering.
Not only that, if as Seventh-day Adventists, we believe that God has been judging the world since, in what's called the pre-Advent judgment, since 1844, hasn't he? So do we need to fear God's judgment?
No.
No.
We know that God's judgment is absolutely and completely fair to everyone, even the devil himself. Well, some theologians have really struggled with Job 42, verse 6, when Job kneels down and says, I repent in dust and ashes. And so they have tried to suggest maybe there are some reasons why. See what you think of these reasons why Job might have needed to repent. One, Job demanded that God give him a visible sign of divine blessing and care. Did Job ever do that?
No.
Job thought that God had become his enemy. Did he really? Job went too far in his lament and complaint. Really?
Absolutely not.
Job suffered from pride? Not at all. Job was dependent on a second-hand religion? Not at all. Who would he have gotten it from? Job was hostile to his friends. This was in a commentary on the book of Job. So we could summarize the book of Job with looking at three or four things. Can God's judgment be trusted? Did Job let God down? Absolutely not. The devil would have done anything to win that case, and he lost. Did God win his case in the book of Job? Absolutely, and the devil was defeated. How did God win his case? By making a pronouncement and said, I'm more powerful. I have control here. You better just believe me and bow down and give reverence. No, God presents the evidence. He says, watch the whole universe. He invites the whole universe to watch Job and his friends. God actually bowed down one time and washed our dirty feet. How many religions, even Christian churches, have that kind of a God? God wins by the way the Spirit works. What is the most important thing that you learned from this study of the book of Job? Our kind and loving Father, what an incredible book we have just had a chance to study together. May we learn the lessons here and take them to heart. May we learn to make them a part of our day-by-day experiences so that we may, like Job, one day be accounted righteous, as our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.